When I was just a little girl, I asked my mother, what will I be? Will I be pretty? Will I be rich? Here's what she said to me. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be. When I grew up and fell in love, I asked my sweetheart, what lies ahead? Will we have rainbows day after day? Here's what my sweetheart said. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be. Now I have children of my own. They ask their mother, what will I be? Will I be handsome? Will I be rich? I tell them tenderly. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be. The future's not ours to see. Que sera, sera. What will be. Que sera, sera.
St. Luke's Hospital started life as the Bradford Union Poor Law Hospital, the first workhouse building being erected in 1850 at a cost of £11,000. Further blocks were added throughout that second half of the 19th century, and the last block, in fact, didn't go up until 1912. By that time, the hospital catered for 700 residents, and it was in that year that the institution was given the name of the Apostle St. Luke. During the First World War, the hospital became a military hospital run by the War Office. The hospital was greatly expanded during the war with the erection of huts at the top end of the hospital grounds. The total number of beds rose to 1,700 and nursing staff increased to 700. At the end of the war, the hospital was taken over by Bradford Corporation and on the 1st of April 1920 became the first municipal general hospital in the country. The setup was experimental for 5 years. In 1926, the Minister of Health, Neville Chamberlain, visited the hospital and expressed his delight with it and sanctioned it as a permanent establishment. A form of nurse training appears to have existed since the 1890s, with a 4-year course including midwifery, culminating in the award of a hospital certificate. The Bright Maternity Unit was opened in 1938 and contrasted with the forbidding stone blocks of the earlier buildings. In the same year, the new nurses' home, on the opposite side of Little Horton Lane, was opened by the then Princess Royal. The new imposing building of the new nurses' home sat in its own grounds behind the Bishop's Palace and contained 240 bedrooms plus recreation and dining facilities.
My mother was very keen on education, so after you left primary school you have to pay for your education. So I wanted to be a nurse, but when we made inquiries in the Dublin hospitals, the fee was £100 and you had to provide your own uniform and you got very little in the way of money. So I decided that I would go to England, come over to England. And at the time there was recruitment by the British in Bray. I live in County Wicklow, Bray, County Wicklow. And there was recruitment for nurses to come to England. So I saw this recruitment officer and I was interviewed. And yes, you could go. And I said I would like to go to Middlesex to train, Middlesex Hospital. But in the event, I then got a letter to say I was going to York. So all the arrangement was made and I duly left Dundee on the boat and came over to Liverpool. We were sent to York. So we got to York and I came out and I had this paper and I said, I'm looking for Bootham Park General Hospital. And this woman said to me, that's where the sillies go. I said, I beg your pardon. I said, I didn't come to do mental training. I said, there's no sign of any training being started and I want to do general training. They said, well, we'll look at it. And they looked at the, they obviously had some papers about us and our education, etc. So then we were sent to go to see St. James's in Leeds or St. Luke's in Bradford. So we went to Leeds to St. James's. Well, it was almost as bad. The accommodation was poor. And I found it very difficult, this poor accommodation. And it was I wasn't impressed. But then we came to Bradford. I said, we'll leave it. We'll let you know. So we came to Bradford. And we came to the new nurse's home and it was delightful. We each had our own room and the accommodation was lovely.
During the Second World War, occupancy of the hospital's beds was controlled by the government's emergency medical service and the hospital catered for both civilian casualties of air raids and injured servicemen, both Allied and enemy.
We didn't go into school at first, we went onto the wards. And so it's just a case of getting to know this bit and that bit. And we had those great big wooden boards that we got about half a dozen, really of those heavy plates on to take out for our meal, for the patient's meal. Mm. Well, I took mine out down one end, 52 patients in all, so half of that one end. And when I came back, I must have just fainted and I dropped the box and I woke up to hearing the matron talking to the sister and saying, what do you think we should do? Do you think she'll make a nurse? Oh, we'll send her up to Westwood and for a year. So that's what happened to me. We finished the general training and then we had to go to, I think it was called M Block at that time, and we did all the midwifery there. And they were very strict and with no comparison to what goes on now. And but it was very interesting. And I can remember being a bit naughty one day. And I brought two babies in from the nursery. And I was saying to one, is this your baby? Is this your baby? Teasing them. It was naughty, wasn't it? But they took it all in good part and they all thrived. Yeah. But it was interesting.
Were you naughty a lot?
Just a little time, isn't it?
A bit cheeky.
Yeah. Well, I can remember, doing general, I remember, I always thought I walked quite nicely and upright and that, and it was a men's ward, and there were, of course, soldiers and etc. And this sister on this ward, she was very stern, and she said, I don't like the way you walk. Right now, walk down this ward, backwards and forwards for me. And then when I was on night duty, they got me up from bed because someone had come to see me. And it was a soldier. My sister had been writing to him via another person, just to give him another letter whilst he was out, you know, on the fighting, you see. And so when he came back, she must have told him about me, so he presented himself at the hospital. And it kept on coming. And he wrote all these letters and the girls were always laughing because they were getting all these letters from him and didn't want them.
So he fancied you a bit, did he? Yes. You weren't interested?
No. No. Well, it's had its ups and downs. but more ups and downs, and I've enjoyed it. It's been interesting and very worthwhile. And if you can bring a smile to somebody's face when you're there for them, it's a very big thing, yes.
So you're glad you didn't stay working in the mill then?
Oh, yes. Yes, definitely.
Yeah. Lovely. Lovely.
I started work at St. Luke's in September 1951, and because I was only 17 and a half, I had to wait until I was 21 to qualify, and I went into the School of Nursing in September with, I think there were 30 girls or young ladies and five other male nurses. It was quite a big training school, probably the biggest in the country for training male nurses, and had a history of taking male students after the Second World War, when many came out from the army, from the medical corps, and took up nurse training. I did my 3 years training in the normal way with everybody else, but when my contemporaries sat their examination, I had to wait another 3 months, because I was too young to be accepted into the nurses' register. And so I sat my examination in February 1955 and qualified. I'd been liable to do national service when I was 18, but because I was training as a nurse, that was deferred until I was 21. And to my dismay, in September 1954, I got my calling up papers to go and sign on for the services, which was before I'd sat my examination. Anyway, the matron managed to get me an extension, probably fairly easy, but through the system of application. And I sat my examinations at the time when I was due, and then stayed at St. Luke's until June of 1955. I'd qualified in March and went to register, so I was a staff nurse and worked in the dermatology ward until it was time to go into the Royal Air Force. I finished up as the Chief Nurse Officer of Bradford.
Right.
And so, you know, they say these come with rations, but they don't actually in the health service. You know, it's not like politics. Mm. So I suddenly found out, you get a letter around October from the Prime Minister. He has in mind to recommend to the Queen that you be made, you know, whatever it is. In my case, it was an OBE, and you have a chance to refuse or accept, and then you mustn't tell anybody. And the letter comes officially in either the new year for the New Year's honours, or in June for the birthday honours. And you know, that sets a chain of events in motion when you get sort of invitation to the palace and things, and told what goes on, and rush out and go into top hat and stuff.
When I was on E3, I decided to shorten my uniform dress. And I'm going up the stairs, and one of the assistant matrons behind me, and she says, "Will you go to the sewing room and get your dress lengthened? I can see your popular deal space, Nurse Breslin." I had a wonderful time with the pantomimes. They were great fun. The doctors used to take part in them as well. And we thoroughly enjoyed them. And then we had the fancy dress balls. We had a Christmas dinner of turkey, and we had to dress up. We always had to wear long dresses at these occasions. I went on to do my midwifery on M Block. And the reason I wanted to do a midwifery was when I was in theatre as a staff nurse on night duty, and the patients had to come across to theatre to have cesareans. And the midwives used to come across, and I thought how very capable they were. They would resuscitate the babies, and they knew what to do. I thought, well, I better have some of this knowledge. And I became a sister in 1952, and things changed a lot, you know, from the keeping patients in bed for 10 days. They now got out of bed after 48 hours. All in all, I have no regrets and thoroughly enjoyed it and made some great friendships. They've been lifelong friendships, really. A lot of them have gone abroad. St. Luke's had a great name. I have friends in America who trained at St. Luke's, in Australia, New Zealand, Africa, and I hear from them every Christmas. I love hearing the news and how things have worked out for them. Some have done very well, others have not enjoyed good health, but it's so nice to keep in touch. But I'm so pleased I trained at St. Luke's. It was a wonderful place. And it's very sad to see it now as it is.
Norma, when did you first decide to become a nurse?
Early teens, I would say, you know, when I was quite young.
And what was it about nursing that appealed to you?
I don't know, I was in the first aid and I did a lot of that and I enjoyed it. So I thought, you know, I'd like to be a nurse, yeah.
And when you first arrived for training, tell me about that.
Oh, I didn't really like it at the start. I was quite homesick. But I got over that. Being the most junior nurse, well, we did have a nurse with us, but not all the time. We had to do a lot of stuff on our own, cleaning more than anything else. That's all we did. I might have made beds, but that would be about that. You know, we didn't do an awful lot. We wouldn't have been allowed to, really.
So yeah. You were glad when you were over that beginning stage?
Yes. I think everything got better. I mean, I'm not saying that the change was all bad. A lot of the stuff was better. For a start, when I came back into nursing, I was off for 5 years having the children. And then when I went back, everything was in packets. I didn't know what was in these packets, you know, so everything just, that took me a long time to get, you know, used to all that sort of thing, because we used to have to set all our own trolleys and know what we had to set on them for these doctors, you know, for the doctors to work. So once I got to know the packets, I was fine again. I mean, I was in a different atmosphere altogether, because it was the Duke of York home I went back into to nurse, for private nursing, and that was completely different, for it was all rooms instead of wards. But once I got, you know, back into it, I loved it again, even though I was working in the BRI.
When did you first meet Norman then?
In 1955. We got married in 1956.
Oh, whirlwind romance then?
Well, it was about 15 months. Yeah.
And was it love at first sight?
Oh, I wouldn't say that. But it was, yeah, we clicked, didn't we? Yeah.
And what was that like then, having to, you know, courting
because we... trying to get our off-duty the same, it was diabolical. I mean, I went on nurse nights, Norman went up to the BRI to do his urology, so the only time we saw there was when I had my 2 nights off. So things were, it was hard, because we couldn't see one another. And that's why we decided to get married quite quickly, because I was paying in the nurse's home to live, and Norman was in a bed sit because his parents moved out of Bradford. So we decided that it would be far cheaper living together, but we had to get married
of course. Yes. did you have to ask matron's permission to get married?
Yes, we had to go to Miss Copeland and ask her if we could get married, and One thing was, and what do you think, what does your aunt think of this then, Nurse Lambay, as it was then? And I says, well, she says, it's all right. I thought, I'm 21, I can get married or not.
When did you decide that you wanted to be a nurse?
About a fortnight before I started. If I backtrack, I left elementary school when I was 14 in 1945. And because national service loomed on the horizon, employers didn't really want teenage boys. Because unless you got an apprenticeship, they knew that you were going when you were 18. Or most did. I mean, some got out of it as conscientious objectors. Others, of course, were turned down on medical grounds, but generally it was an assumption that all 18-year-old boys would be going into the forces at that age. I saw an advert for student mental nurses down in Somerset, so I applied, as I say, a fortnight before, and they said, can you start on a certain date? And I went, and I did 6 months of mental nursing and thought, I'm going to land up as daft as the patients in this game. And my cousin, who trained as a nurse at St. Luke's, said, why don't you go to St. Luke's and see if you can get on as a male nurse there. So I got the bus and I went up and I went to matron's office and asked if I could see the matron. And the secretary took me into Miss Copeland and I was interviewed by her and, you know, why do I want to be a nurse and one thing and another.
What was your answer?
And I said, well, I just fancy it. I've liked the idea of being a nurse but didn't like mental nursing. So she said, right, you can start. Can you start next Monday? I said yes. I've resigned already. I'm back home from Somerset. So she said, right, well, report to the preliminary training school in the nurses' home on Monday morning, and we'll see you then. And as I got up to go, she said, just wait a moment. And she opened the desk drawer and took a sheet of paper out and handed it to me. She says, this is your application form. Fill it in and give it to the principal tutor when you report on Monday morning. So that's how I started as a nurse. A very informal arrangement.
Did you ever feel any prejudice against you because you were a male nurse?
No, I wouldn't say there was prejudice. As I say, there was always this undercurrent of not really ill feeling. Male nurses were seen more because we were in the minority. Yeah. But we were valuable for some things, like dealing with obstreperous patients and things like that, of course.
So what do you think it was about St. Luke's that meant that it wasn't like that, it wasn't prejudice and it had...
No, I think it was more of a family atmosphere. And I think having evolved from being a municipal hospital, they'd always had a lot of male staff who were part of a sort of the corporation's family, as you might say. You know, it was run by Bradford Corporation. And in fact, there was a funny thing that male nurses were still classed as local government officers. Goodness knows why. I mean, it became an NHS hospital in 1948. And when we went to breakfast in the non-resident's dining room, we got a cooked breakfast, whereas the female non-resident nurses got bread and dripping. You know, and this was a hark back to when it had been a municipal hospital and the men always had a cooked breakfast, you know, and it still went on in the 1950s, you know, years afterwards. And the female nurses used to be sneaking over trying to get some of our bacon and stuff like that to put on the bread.
So what was it like the first time you went on the ward as a nurse?
Well, you see, in the preliminary training school, the female students had to work in the morning up till classes started at 9 o'clock, doing domestic work around the nurse's home and the classrooms and cleaning the classrooms and everything, whereas the male nurses had to go and work on the ward. So right from the beginning, I was into a ward from 7:30 in the morning till 8:30, and then breakfast. And that was just purely cleaning. I never did any nursing work at all. It was just cleaning beds and the toilets and things like that. And my first ward was A2, and Sister 7 was notorious for being a bit, dictatorial. And I can always remember climbing up on the toilet seat to reach up to the dividing bar of the toilet cubicles to rub a finger on it.
What did you think when you first saw Norma then?
Well, I think it was love at first sight, I reckon. She had quite a fiery temper. She was a redhead and had quite a fiery temper. And I don't know whether that's what drew her to me, but we were working on the... We initially met on the dermatology ward. I think it became so obvious that they locked us in the linen room one day, and I wasn't allowed out until I'd asked Norman out for a date.
So I started nurse training in 1954 at St. Luke's Hospital, and when I applied for nursing, this little leaflet was sent to me, which talks about the nurses' training school, which was held in the nurses' home, and it gives a little bit of insight into students' rooms and things like that, and it shows some of the practicalities of nurse training there, but also some of the fun things, because we often had pantomimes or whatever. We had little training books. This was a book that's a record of my practical experiences, all of the things that I did on the different wards. Mm-hmm. And the ward sisters had to sign when I'd completed various training tasks. Record of practical instruction. And that had to be carried with me for the whole of the 3 years and signed by the different ward sisters. I also kept my old nursing notebooks. It's been really quite fun going through these and looking at this one on nursing ethics and etiquette and care of equipment and rubber sheets should never be folded as they may crack. We had these ghastly rubber sheets which we had underneath the basic sheet that people slept on. It made them perspire like mad. Qualities towards senior members of the staff. This should always be...
show respect and obedience.
Yes, yes.
And so was the matron a scary figure?
No, matron was very, very gentle actually. Oh, really? But there were some deputies that were a little bit less so. There was one deputy, Miss Dennis, and she had a dog called Coco. And believe it or not, when she did ward rounds, Coco the dog came with her.
Is that right?
It was a poodle. Yeah.
From the time you started until you retired, what do you think were the main changes of practices, so the day-to-day practices of things? Are there any things that stand out that were different?
I think respect is one of the biggest things for staff, for seniority. No time in my one of these training manuals, it tells me how to address the doctors and the surgeons, the consultants. Everybody was addressed as sir or doctor, matron as matron. And nowadays you get everybody addressing each other by Christian name. And there's nothing wrong, or first name I should say. And not that there's anything wrong in that, but it's quite a change. Changes in uniforms, we did know there was a distinction between the uniforms in my day, but it's much less so now, as we were saying earlier.
Yeah.
It's difficult to tell who is who.
Yeah.
With all the same colour. Other changes, well, there's much more modernisation now and things have moved on. I don't think that they have the procedure of cleaning out bed puns as I knew it. We used to have some lovely dancers dancers in the nurses' home.
Mm.
I'm just flicking my mind back to doctors. There were various occasions when they would climb to the flagpole mast on top of the nurses' home and fix bed puns, ably assisted by nursing staff.
Mm.
So had bedpans flying from the flag mast on top of the nurse's home. Okay, so a lot of this really goes back to the very beginning. I wore a tail cap, and these are the white clips that I used to wear to fasten the tail clip, fasten the tail cap onto my head, and then later got to a small cap as I got more senior. So that's from the very beginning. St. Luke's Hospital, Bradford, quisque pro omnes, which I've always been told means each for all, and that I felt very, very proud of. I myself had it engraved with my name and dates of training because I just was so proud of it.
On July the 1st, 1948, a matron was appointed to oversee the maternity unit. This was only a few days before the appointed day when the hospital came under the control of the Ministry of Health. By this time, the general hospital had 828 beds and the paternity hospital 123. At a special ceremony, the hospital was transferred from the control of the local authority to the newly created Bradford A Group Hospital Management Committee.
Right, well, my first recollections of working at St. Luke's was in 1947. I was seconded from BRI when I started training there in March, in May the 10th, 1946. On payday, we used to go down to Collinson's Cafe in town on Tyrrell Street, and we were known as Miss Mary's Little Ladies. And Miss Mary often used to stand at the front entrance. She would see that our dresses, and we were allowed gabardine coats, were 2 inches below our knee, and we had our gabardines on and a little gabardine pork pie hat. So off we would go, you see, get on the bus and go down there. We always went to Collinson's. And at that time they had a little orchestra in Collinson's. I don't know if you remember this, but five men orchestra playing Perchance to Dream or We'll Gather Lilacs or something like that. And St. Luke's lot had also come in, and they sat at the other side and we sat here. This rivalry was, and one of the St. Luke's nurses shouted across the orchestra, "Miss Mary's little ladies, I beg you to take your hats off." So Maudie Flanagan, who later became a nun, one of our group, took her hat off and threw it across the orchestra into the lap of the... And back came a half-eaten chocolate eclair, because this was why we'd gone, this gorgeous coffee and these lovely chocolate eclairs, threw this half-eaten chocolate eclair right across the orchestra, missing them, and landing on our side. And it started, hats, biscuits, and the manager came in and he separated us and made us go outside. He must have rung our matron and to go back on the bus and straight to the matron's office. And I think she had a smile on her face, really, because matron of St. Luke's would also be dealing with their lot there. And she gave us a ticking off, saying she didn't expect her little ladies to to behave like this. And the penalty was we would have our late pass stopped for the next 3 months. And this meant a lot to us. I was posted to BMH in Singapore, and I was there nearly 2 years, but I hated it. It was the most unhappy period in nursing. I mean, when I went for my interview for the QAs, they said, "Which speciality did I like?" And I said, "Well, medicine." Anyway, I arrived in Singapore, and there's an incident on the way. We went on forgotten the name of the ship now, but we were stuck in the Suez Canal. It was in 56 when, that was on. And we'd wait there for 4 days until we would either have to come back or be allowed through. And we were allowed through, arriving in Singapore.
had been made. But they put me on night duty the night after I arrived. I couldn't speak a word of Malay. And they put me on night duty on the Malay ward. And it was very difficult because the Malays came in and they didn't come on the delivery table. They would squat in a corner. And I soon got to know the words. Sicky sacky meant little pain. Banya sacky meant big pain. And susu meant milk. And a lot of these babies were stillborn. It was a very unhappy period compared to the midwifery I had done. You know, it was pretty grim, really. My husband had trained at St. Luke's years and years ago, and it was only then when I felt I was a real St. Luke's girl, because I'd married a St. Luke's fella. So that, you know, that was it. So I've only really just settled down into retirement. It's I do Scotty Rescue all over West Yorkshire. We rehouse dogs. It takes more paperwork rehousing a dog than it did a patient, I can tell you. You have to do care plans. You know, I've come to the stage now, only just now, when I can say, when did I find time to work? You know, that was me and my career.
I grew up in Bradford, in St. Mary's Parish, and I belonged to a group called the Legion of Mary. We used to go out into old people's homes helping them, and on a Sunday we used to go to Carverley Hospital to work there with the patients, and that's when I realised that that's what I wanted to do. I started on the 20th of June 1955 at St. Luke's Hospital. It was a lovely sunny day. And my father brought me with my suitcase with him on the bus, got off at the end of the drive, and men weren't allowed down the drive of the nurses' home then, unless the home sister knew that they were coming. And so my father had to leave me to struggle down the drive with my suitcase. That was my first day. Then our first visits to the wards were to make beds. You'd make unoccupied beds, and then you would make beds with patients in, but because you'd been practicing with each other, you had a little bit of an idea. The difference being when you got to the wards, the patients weren't as nimble as the 18-year-olds you'd been, you know, turn over, roll this way, lift yourself up, down. So our practical training was excellent. Our theoretical training was excellent. Our practical training was excellent. But it was backed up by visits, regular visits to the ward with the sister from the school. You went with the sister from the school to the ward, and she supervised you whilst you were doing these tasks. Yes, I'm very proud of being a Bradfordian, and I get very cross with people who say that Bradford is on its down, you know, it's on its uppers, and there's nothing good about Bradford. The only good thing about Bradford are the roads leading out of it. This really makes me cross. And if I do raise my voice about anything, it will be to tell people about, you know, well, stop and look at the positive things. Bradford, over the years, Bradford has many things historically that we can be very proud of. The people I'm very proud of who've made their mark in history are the surgeon I worked for, George White Watson. I worked for him when I was a staff nurse after I'd completed my training. I completed my training in August of 1958. George White Watson was from Ulster, and Robert Turner was a Scot. But both these men worked together tirelessly over years to pioneer chemotherapy, the treatment we know as chemotherapy, which is used for treatment of malignancy in this day and age. It all started in Bradford in 1958. The pioneering trials were in 1958. If you look at the history books and you read the journals,
it will say it started in 1959 at the Bradford Royal Infirmary. This is untrue. It started in 1958 at St. Luke's Hospital. But because those were clinical trials being pioneered, it had to be kept fairly hush-hush because of the nature of the treatment that we were using. We were using toxic substances, putting them into people's bodies in an attempt to kill the malignancy, the malignant cells that were in the body already causing problems. So yes, Bradford has many things. The Bradfordians have many things to be proud of with their city. And the things that happened here. Would you?
And tell us about the plaque you're campaigning for.
The treatment started, as I say, in 1958. It was in the autumn of 1958. And Mr. White Watson asked the ward sister to speak to me, to ask if I would be interested in working with him. And another doctor who was called Dr. Breckenridge. He worked part-time as a surgical registrar and he worked part-time as a GP in Shipley. And they wanted a nurse to be involved in the clinical trials. So Sister spoke to me and then Mr. White Watson spoke to me to ask if I would be interested in being the nurse to start these treatments, because we didn't know how toxic the substances were, and we didn't know whether they would affect the people giving the drugs as well as the people receiving the drugs. So they had to have my written consent to be involved in this. And
were you apprehensive about doing that?
I was very humbled to be asked to take part in trials like this. Their families know. And it would be nice for that child, she's grown now, she's a grown lady herself now, but for that child to know my mother gave her life so that other people would be able to have a longer expectation of life and to be able to be around when all the advances. There are so many drugs now that are in use and so many treatments that are successful, and people no longer look on it as a death sentence. When they are told they have some form of cancer. There are some forms that are more malignant than others. But at least you have a fighting chance, which we didn't have, or really didn't have all those years ago.
So, Pat, when did you decide that you wanted to be a nurse?
4 years old.
Oh, really?
And I really, you know, kept up to, you know, this being wanting to be a nurse. So when I was 17, I went to, as a pre-trainee to Woodlands Orthopaedic Hospital.
And what was your first training like? Did you find it difficult?
In some ways, it was a bit more. We were treated more as grown-ups, whereas we'd been at Woodlands and we treated as very much 16, 17-year-olds. So we had a bit more freedom at St. Luke's. We could actually stay out till 11 o'clock.
Oh.
If you had a pass?
No, you didn't need a pass.
Oh really?
You had a pass at, you go to 12 o'clock. Mm. And we had to go across to the hospital. My sister would, if there were a pubis, she'd walk us all across to the nurse's home. And that was your late night, 12 o'clock.
And where would you go on your nights out?
We'd go to, you know, the pictures. We went dancing quite a lot. Oh, there was the Odeon in Bradford, which is a bit derelict now. But it was the Gourmand Ballroom at the time, and they had dances on Wednesdays and Saturdays. So and that was one of the places we used to go for our leisure.
What did you enjoy about dancing? Did everyone go, nurses and doctors? And
We didn't associate too much with the doctors.
Oh, really? Why, because it was frowned upon, or because was there was a snobbery?
It was sort of frowned upon, you didn't associate with them.
Mm-hmm. So what about boyfriends and things, who you went to the dance with?
I met my husband at a dance. They weren't allowed in the nurse's home. You know, you could sneak them in. There was a little tiny sitting room there. They could actually wait, but, you know, that was as far as they ever got. And, you know, if they ever got upstairs, which I'm sure they did, but it was frowned upon.
And if you got caught, what would happen to you?
I don't know, because I didn't care.
What was it like the first day that you actually went on a ward and was in contact with patients?
We did a lot of manual things. We did lots of the cleaning and, you know, doing the lockers. Apart from our usual, you know, making the patients comfortable.
What was your favourite part of nursing? Was there a particular ward you liked working on, or a particular element of the job that you enjoyed?
I liked the surgical ward. It was a lot. It was the length of time, you know, that we would work from something like 8:30 till 8:15 in the morning. So it was nearly 12 hours.
The nights
then were very long.
Mm-hmm.
What was special about St. Luke's, do you think?
That we got a good training. Our matron of the time, she was always interested in what we were doing, and also she put, you know, the patients and, you know, the nurses.
Was this Miss Copeland?
That was Miss Copeland.
Mm. Tell us about Miss Copeland. We've heard she was really special. Can you sum up why?
She felt that we should... We were there to nurse, and she, you know, she wanted the people who trained at St. Luke's to be good nurses.
In the late 1960s, plans were being developed to build a new district general hospital on the site of St. Luke's, and the winding down of the existing facilities began, so that by 1974, the hospital had only 152 general medical beds and 97 general surgery beds, plus a number of specialties. In 1985, the go-ahead was given to demolish parts of the hospital, ready for the building of the new Horton Wing. The decision to build a new district general hospital having been shelved, and Bradford Royal Infirmary designated as the district general hospital. At last we saw the end of the temporary wooden huts built, if you remember, in the First World War, and the demise also of Hometop House, which had been the matron's residence for many years. In 1987, it was decided to shut the Bradford Children's Hospital, and these facilities were transferred to St. Luke's, but in the 1990s were transferred up to the Bradford Royal Infirmary. In 1990, the foundation stone of the Horton Wing was laid, and this modern facility opened in the mid-1990s. Currently, most of the old Victorian buildings are unoccupied or used only for ancillary services, whilst the new nurses' home is owned now by the University of Bradford.
Many parts of the old St. Luke's buildings are now being used as a set for the Yorkshire television series The Royal, a hospital drama set in the 1960s. The group of retired nurses spent a day looking around, as it may have been when they worked there.
Yes, yes, my baby said yes, yes, instead of no, no. Sunday. I didn't say Monday. It's gotta be Sunday. We're ready to go. So Gaga, we're gonna go Gaga. My baby loves Gaga. She told me so. Yes, yes. My baby said yes, yes. I'm glad she said yes, yes. Instead of no, no.